Kind of walk up to the green, and yeah, first thing would be the lie, I guess. Yeah, as you walk in the green, you're kind of assessing what shot you've got. You can usually tell if it's, you know, you're short sighted or you've got a lot of green to work with. So you're kind of just filtering all that information, and then first thing's a lie. So obviously, if you're on a nice bit of fairway like this, a nice lie, then you've got a lot of options. You can kind of do whatever you want, but then it's just the whatever the situation is dictates the shot. So in this case, like to the left pin here, obviously got a lot of green to work with. I've got a nice lie. I would just, for me, I like to change the club a lot. I kind of have the same chipping technique with most shots, but then I like to change the club. So for this shot, yeah, I would just, I'd probably use a pitching wedge and just pick a landing spot, you practice swings, and then just try and hit it. And then obviously for the shorter pin here, yeah, again, just taking in all the information. If you've got lie, greens are soft, greens are hard, that would dictate the shot. So here, I'd probably be hitting a lob wedge or a sandwich with essentially the same chipping technique that I used for the pitching wedge here. And then similar for the far pin, it would be, you know, maybe an 8-iron or a 9-iron or something like that.
But it's a bump and runs, yeah?
Yeah, bump and runs, yeah. So,
are you a massive advocate of getting the ball on the ground as possible?
That's how I was taught. And that's, yeah, like when I was learning chipping, like my coach used to refer to Sebi a lot, and Sebi was always, he always tried to land it like just on the green. So no matter where he was, he'd want to land the ball just on the green. So here he'd be using a, I don't know, 9 or an 8-9 or whatever, and almost use the fringe as a bit of a reference. You do see a lot of guys now just using the same club. They use a lob wedge for every single shot, which I guess the theory behind that is you're using the same club, so you should be really dialed into that one club, which kind of makes sense. But for me personally, I like to, I don't know, it just feels like you've got a lot of margin for error on it. When you've got a pitching wedge and you're just bumping and running it, it's easy to strike it well, and you know, it doesn't spin up or whatever. It just feels a lot more predictable to me. So that's how I was taught, and that's kind of how I've always done it. So yeah, I can hit a few, I guess.
And what's your setup?
Yes, I've got four wedges. I've got a 60 degree, a 55, a 50, and then my pitching wedge, which is, I think it's about 46 degrees. It's obviously very well gapped. I've got kind of very consistent gaps throughout them. And for me, my game's built on more kind of precision and accuracy in wedge play. I'm not the biggest guy, so like I can't overpower a golf course. You know, I hit it about average distance, so that's why I don't have an extra wood or long iron in. I prefer to go with the extra wedge, just because I feel that's where I make my score. That's what I'm good at, and I try and give myself as many options with those clubs as possible. You see a lot of the longer hitters seem to have maybe three wedges because their game is maybe more built on longer clubs and hit more lines and stuff. So yeah, I go with the four wedges and have them 5 degrees apart. So in theory, obviously, the gaps between them are consistent, and then I have a kind of a system to fill those gaps, you know, with half swings and three-quarter swings and all that stuff. So, yeah, put a couple of salt for the runner. Yeah. Like basically all I'm thinking about when I hit a chip is just really looking at the landing spot and just trying to feel how much the ball is going to roll, and then really kind of looking at those two things and just feeling how hard I need to hit it, you know, where I want to strike it. And then I just try and keep that on there.
So what's that club? Is that a pitching wedge?
That was a pitching wedge, yeah. And obviously for this pin at the right, you need just maybe a little bit more loft. So probably go over like a 56. And
do you have any sort of reference you used to look where you want to land the ball? Just don't feel those
degrees? Yeah, just feel. I mean, obviously in practice and the stuff, we do a lot of work like hit chip speeds to figure out how fast you are, hard you are, all that stuff. And we obviously have different grasses and roughs to contend with, so you kind of spend your prep time getting dialed in all those different things. But as far as like, I like to pick a landing spot as well. I kind of pick my landing spot and then match the kind of height of the chip to that. And so like here, I would be looking at it and I probably want to land it about 6 feet on the green. And I'm seeing it just kind of checking up a bit and then just just rolling the rest of the way. And then I guess I've just done, you know, in theory I've done that much practice that, you know, I'm just on my practice strokes, I'm really trying to feel and visualize that shot, and then I just try and repeat it.
Get in.
Yeah, it's one of the things I can do well. It's different. But yeah, it's, I guess the nice thing at my level, like my chipping technique's really good, so that allows me to focus purely on the shot and really get into the feel of the shot, whereas if you've got a bit of a dodgy chipping action and you're striking it inconsistently, then it makes it really hard to get into the shot like that. So
do you ever work on technique now, or is that kind of just dealt with? And
no, I do. The main way I do it actually is actually chip off the green, and I basically hit shots. Don't tell my green keeper how I do this, but like, I figured if I can strike it well off a green, then when I put the ball on fairway, it seems really easy.
Okay.
Yeah, we probably shouldn't all do that when we get back.
Yeah.
Chris,
I lie.
But I'll say Chris said it was okay.
Chris said it was fine.
So like, obviously what you don't want to do if you're chipping off a green is get your leading edge going forward, because then it's going to dig and you're really going to upset the greenkeeper. So the main thing I think about when I'm chipping is I'm thinking about using the bounce, like this back part of the bounce here. Yeah, I'm kind of not, I'm hitting the ground fairly hard there, but I'm not taking the divot. And I'll just hit one. And I know if I'm chipping it well off a green like that, I know that my strike's really good, so then that's taken care of, and now I just worry about the, you know, control of the distance and height and all that stuff. You know. Yeah, maybe not try that one straight.
Yeah.
So the ball bounced and then just stopped. Did you do some, is that ball in the swing? Is that the club?
It's kind of, I guess it's a lot of it's lie dependent. It's like off the green, like this, there's such a tight lie, just you easily get a lot of spin. A lot of it is like quality of strike, you know, if you're hitting it out the middle, hitting it with the right amount of bounce and hitting the ground at the right time, it just kind of happens. I'm not thinking about putting loads of spin on it or anything, it's just, I guess it's the, and just the correct technique. I almost wouldn't know how to put more spin on it, because if you just hit it correctly, then that comes, you know. A lot of times we're trying not to get spin, you know, especially when the pin's up at the back, you know, that's when you take the 9-iron on the pitch, you might just get one that's going to run, because sometimes spin can be a bit of an enemy when it takes up too much or what have you. So.
And do you have any method for distance of like, oh, I'm taking my hands back to 7 or 8 or 9?
Not with chipping.
No.
Personally, I do that with like more full wedges. I don't know if any of you know about the Pels clock system.
Yeah.
So like, he has different clocks. So like, you swing here, this would be 10 o'clock on the clock, and then 9 o'clock, 8 o'clock, all that. So I use those for more full shots, but I do a lot of work. I'll just go around the chipping green and even trying to land the ball in the hole, and just gives me a feel and awareness of hitting my landing spot, basically. So you need to have a lot of feel, I think, if you're chipping, and if you get too into positions and stuff, then you'll probably lose the strike, and it makes it really difficult from that sense. But I just spend the hours kind of chipping and developing that feel.
You can try and stay stable there, or are you actually moving with your arms?
Yeah, so to me it almost feels quite wooden to me. I haven't got too much wrist hinge, because that adds in a bit of inconsistency. To me it feels like it's, you know, there is a bit of wrist hinge, but it feels quite wooden going back, and then I'm kind of returning the club almost to my setup position, and I'm controlling it mainly with my body. So it feels good. It's quite a simple action. You know, you see some people getting the wrists involved and the knees start going, and you need your low point to be the same every time, and I guess the less amount of variables the better when it comes to that. So
can I ask where your wrists are when you contact the ball? You keep it in front of the ball?
No, I like to have it fairly straight up. If I get too much lean, then the club starts digging, and then gets the greenkeeper off, getting off the green. So, but you obviously don't want to be flicking at it either, because that's when you hit behind it and thin it. So it's, to me, it's just kind of a tiny bit of wrist set, and then it just returns to where you were with the dress.
So is the ball at setup behind where your low point would be at impact? Do you know what I mean?
Yes, I mean, my ball position, I have it kind of on my left heel, I suppose, and then, yeah, I'm thinking when I do my practice swings, the low point is about there, I guess, isn't it? Yeah.
So just behind
you? Yeah, just ahead of the ball, and then I just do that. Anyone have a go off the green?
No, best not.
I'll have a go, whether it damages you or not.